So the topic of my talk today will be exploring the question of whether statistical models truly understand the world. And the main tool that I'll use to explore this question is the creation of what we call adversarial examples. I've heard a few people ask other speakers earlier today about these examples where you change pixels only a very small amount and you cause a deep network to get the wrong result. So now I'll give you the latest details in a relatively non-technical and informal way. The reason that adversarial examples have become interesting recently is that if you evaluate neural networks on clean, ordinary examples drawn from actual data sets, they have reached human-level performance on a variety of different tasks, like object recognition, face recognition, breaking CAPTCHAs, transcribing street numbers, and so on. The fact that they're able to perform as well as people on these tasks might imply that they actually work as well as the human visual system does. But we know by creating adversarial examples that they don't necessarily. This has some kind of interesting philosophical implications. People have thought about whether AI systems can actually understand the tasks that we ask them to perform for a long time before they even began to succeed at these tasks. And one of the original ways of exploring the topic of whether a system understands its task or not is the Chinese room thought experiment. The idea behind this thought experiment is to suppose that you have a person who does not speak Chinese, and they sit inside a room with a slot that you can pass notes through. If people pass notes with Chinese sentences written on them, and the person in the room can consult an instruction book that tells them how to reply to each possible note, and then they write a reply and pass it back through, they don't actually know what the sentence is about, they're only following the instruction book. And John Searle's argument is that the person in this situation does not understand what they're doing. We could infer from that an AI system that is only capable of following explicit instructions does not actually understand its task yet. One way that we can operationalize this idea and test whether a system understands what it is doing is to provide it with some kind of input that is not in its instruction book. So if we give this example Chinese sentence here where we don't have a translation on the right side, those of us like me who don't speak Chinese do not know how to reply. For neural networks and other statistical models, the instruction book that we provide the system is the instruction that it should find the probability distribution that explains the training data, and then run inference in that probability distribution to label new inputs. One way that we can come up with inputs that do not appear in this form of instruction book is to provide the system with inputs that are statistically unusual and would not be generated by the same process that generated the training data. Specifically, we can do this by looking at the sign of the gradient of the cost function used to train the model with respect to its inputs. And we can simply follow that gradient uphill for a small amount at each input pixel. Using the sign rather than the gradient itself allows us to make the most catastrophic change at each pixel separately. So here we see on the left, we have an input image, which is a panda. Both we as people and the neural net agree that this image is of a panda. If we follow the gradient of the neural network's loss function, we obtain this image that looks just kind of like colorful television static. It doesn't look like anything meaningful to a person. This turns out to be exactly the direction that makes the neural network less confident that this is a panda at the maximum possible rate. If we add a very small amount of that image, so small that it doesn't actually change the encoding of the image when stored in 8 bits, we can produce a new image that a human can't tell the difference from the original and the new one, but the neural network believes with 99% confidence that the new image is a given. This same procedure works about 98% of the time. Regardless of what input image we put in, we can usually get something where we're able to make the neural network confidently output the wrong class. And on data sets that are large and high dimensional, like ImageNet, the changes are often so small that human beings can't even see them. So this suggests that neural networks don't actually understand what they're doing. And it turns out most other statistical models that we've studied don't either. This is not a problem that's particular to deep learning. People originally thought that this issue resulted from overfitting and highly complicated functions. So it's been known for a little bit over a year, or it's been public for a little bit over a year, that these adversarial examples exist. And most explanations say that if you have some kind of training set, like this example of 3 X's and 4 O's, that you could infer this very complicated and random structure that explains all of them. The blue patches represent where the network thinks that there should be X's, and the green patches represent where the network thinks that there should be O's. And you can see there's a little red X and a little red O representing where this kind of random, unjustified, highly complicated function has decided to place X's and O's erroneously. Those points, the red X is very close to the blue X's, and the classification function has put green probability mass around it, signifying that it thinks it should be an O. However, it's also possible to get adversarial examples from underfitting. Here we have the same training data set, and we've separated the X's from the O's with a linear dividing line. You can see there's a red O and a red X that are misclassified by this decision function. A human would say that, you know, the O on the left is very close to the training set green O's and classified as an O, but this linear dividing line classifies it as being an X. People have somewhat misleading intuitions about the way that low capacity models behave, and this has led people to think that only high capacity models could have adversarial examples. In fact, in the case of linear models, it's actually quite easy to get adversarial examples, because linear models become extremely confident when extrapolating to points far from the data. In this example training set on the top, the blue X's represent one cluster of one class. The green O's represent another cluster of another class. And the red line represents the linear increase in confidence as you move from left to right. Where it is very negative, it believes strongly that there are X's. Where it's very positive, it believes strongly that there are O's. In order for it to be confident where the training set X's are and where the training set O's are, it must become even more confident in the margins of this slide. So if it believes that there are X's toward the middle of the slide, it must believe even more strongly that there are X's far out toward the left of the slide where it has not actually seen any data. Other kinds of models, such as RBF classifiers, actually do behave in the way that people tend to expect low capacity models to behave. In the lower row of the slide, we can see that this RBF model places a small bump of probability mass on the X's and another small bump of probability mass on the O's. And when you move far from the data, it's not very confident. It turns out that linear classifiers like logistic regression and softmax regression are vulnerable to our formula for creating adversarial examples. But RBF classifiers are, by comparison, quite robust to this formula. So if RBF classifiers are so much more robust to adversarial examples, why do all of modern neural networks look so linear? You can see that rectified linear units are piecewise linear, maxout units are piecewise linear, sigmoid nets, when they've been tuned to operate mostly in their linear regime, as we need to do to successfully train them, also behave very much like piecewise linear models. And LSTMs involve summation over time, which is the simplest kind of linear operation that we could perform from one time step to the next. So while we've seen that linear models are very vulnerable to adversarial perturbation, that also seems to be the basis of all of modern deep learning. And in fact, when we look at the way that deep learning models change their prediction throughout space, we can see that they behave in this very piecewise linear fashion where they extrapolate overconfidently as you move farther and farther away from the data. What's going on in this plot is that we show how the network responds to different perturbations of the input. In the image on the right, we show a sequence of images formed by adding first a strong negative perturbation, and then gradually as you move left to right, top to bottom, less and less perturbation until we reach a data point, which is this image of the four. And then we add more perturbation as we continue to move left to right, top to bottom, and we get the negative of the original image at the upper left. So as we sweep out this trajectory and input space, in the plot on the left, we show the way that the arguments to the softmax classifier at the top of a deep model change throughout this trajectory. We can see that on the left and right ends of the trajectory, where we're far from the data, the arguments to the softmax are very extreme, and so the softmax is confidently predicting one specific class, even though the inputs do not resemble any of the numbers that the network has been trained to recognize. Toward the very center, right close to the data, the network is actually making a reasonable prediction, which is that it's a four with fairly high confidence, but not the kind of extreme confidence that we have at the margins. So this shows that the network has learned to fake the correct behavior on this task, but only close to the data, only where our instruction book of learning the training set probability distribution is applicable. When we ask it to figure out what to do in the absence of instructions, it's completely lost and makes very strong, high confidence, incorrect predictions. To get an intuition for how this works, let's look at a logistic regression model. On the left, I show you the weights of the logistic regression model for telling threes from sevens. These weights are relatively bright, where a pixel being white means it's more likely to be a seven than a three, and relatively dark, where they're more likely to be a three than a seven. This gives us something that's roughly similar to the correlation between each pixel in the class. If we then take the sine of those weights, we know exactly how we should change each pixel to confuse the classifier. And then on the right, I show you clean examples and adversarial examples produced just by adding or subtracting a small amount of this signed weight image. As human beings, we can still see the original threes and the sevens in the adversarial examples. But a logistic regression model doesn't have any kind of attention mechanism to separate the background from the foreground. And because it's a linear model, all it can do is add up small pieces of information across the image. Even though each pixel only votes very weakly for whichever class we choose to force it to output, when it has to add up nearly 800 different pixels of evidence that we have modified to all point in one direction, it will become highly confident that the answer is whatever we chose it to be, based on whether we subtracted or added this sine of the weights image. So why do we use these linear models if they're so easy to confuse? The reason is that we have to, because we don't really know how to train anything else. We train most of our models using gradient-based methods, whether they're literally stochastic gradient descent or more complicated gradient-based methods like Hessian free optimization that still make use of the gradient. We compute these gradients using backpropagation. And if you trace the backpropagation path from the output label at the top of the model back down to the red input pixel, you can see I've drawn a little green path where the gradient must be large if we want to train the weight leading from this input pixel to one of the hidden units right above it. If we want to be able to train that weight, we need that gradient to be large. But if that weight is non-zero and that gradient is large, that means that the gradient with respect to the input pixel that I've highlighted must also be large. So models that are easy to train are also intrinsically easy to confuse by slightly modifying their inputs. This suggests that we might need to come up with more complicated training methods that are not exclusively based on the gradient to figure out how to make large moves on models that have very flat response curves, if we want to overcome the problem of adversarial examples. One thing that's interesting about deep models is that they're capable of representing any function to an arbitrary degree of accuracy. That means that even if the optimizer has trouble finding it, they are guaranteed to at least be able to represent a function that's resistant to adversarial examples. And this is one way that deep networks have a crucial advantage over shallow models like linear networks. If we train deep networks on a mixture of adversarial and clean examples, they get better over time. In the plot on the right, the green curve represents the error rate on adversarial examples when training with adversarial examples included in the training data. The blue curve represents what happens if we do not include these adversarial examples in the training set. So as the blue curve shows, standard training algorithms do almost nothing to reduce the error rate on adversarial examples. On the left, I show what happens when we evaluate the same model on clean examples. It's the same training process, but we're looking at how well this model performs on uncorrupted inputs. And it turns out that it actually does quite well on these adversarial examples, on these clean examples when trained on adversarial examples. This is a little bit unusual because the adversarial examples never appear in this test data set. But by including the adversarial examples, we've forced the model to discover concepts that are closer to the true concept explaining how to classify the data. In the future, there's a lot of work to do to figure out how to encourage true understanding. Training on adversarial examples is essentially just expanding the instruction book that we provide to our models. They're not learning how to figure out the underlying pattern in the instruction book and process any new example correctly. Several people think that generative models have the potential to confer resistance to adversarial examples. I've run some tests on some existing generative models, and they actually are not resistant to these adversarial examples, but it's possible that other kinds of generative models could be. Finally, I also think it's promising to train agents that can interact with an environment, and when they learn to understand the dynamics of this environment, they might learn the structure of the true task. If you're interested in technical details of any of this work and seeing actual quantitative experiments and some more details about how you can predict exactly how adversarial examples will be formed and how they will be labeled, then I'd encourage you to look at these two publications from my team over the last year. I'm free for questions. Go ahead.
So you've looked at adversarial examples, but have you done the comparison with like other data augmentation to see how comparatively the learning improves with the various different types of data augmentation?
Oh, like which one has the most marginal benefit?
Yeah,
I haven't attempted to compare which form has the most marginal benefit. What I did was I started with the state of the art on a specific task. And so the adversarial data augmentation is in addition to other things like using dropout to augment the data by having different subsets of zeros in it and things like that. And in some of my other experiments, I also applied it in addition to things like shifts of the image and flips of the image, like people use for training convolutional nets. But I haven't attempted to quantify which one is the most beneficial on its own.
Thanks, Ian. That was really great and really interesting. One of your comments just made me wonder something. So you were talking about RBFs being somewhat more resistant. And it made me wonder, so in the case where you do some kind of contrast normalization, you're basically putting your layers on the surface of the hypersphere, and if you also have some kind of weight normalization and a bias offset, then you're effectively having basis functions on the surface of that hypersphere. I was just wondering if you'd kind of thought about that as well, or if you'd looked at that, or if you have any intuition as to whether that would help.
Yeah, so in this talk, I tried to focus very much on linear generation of adversarial examples and the way that they affect the hidden units. But it turns out that if you impose any kind of manifold, you can basically do derivatives along that manifold to find directions on that manifold that are harmful. So you can also form adversarial examples by rotating the input or rotating different hidden layers in certain directions. And so in that case, normalization can prevent you from moving in the direction that a direct linear path in Euclidean space would want to move. But you can just do the differentiation along the normalized manifold and rotate in that direction. And that will reliably confuse the network as well. Yeah, I've tried a variety of things like that to see if they could confer resistance, and I haven't succeeded yet. Actually, even when coupled with adversarial training, they don't seem to make a whole lot of improvement. Essentially. It's important to update the set of adversarial examples on each mini batch rather than to use the same one continuously over time, because the set of adversarial examples is a function of the network's weights.